Wake up! It's the Sleep Unplugged podcast, episode 45. Are you a good sleeper or a bad sleeper? It was my attitude. Welcome, everyone, to the Sleep Unplugged podcast. My name is Dr. Chris Winner, neurologist and sleep specialist. This is the first Monday of the month. And so because of that, this is an episode on insomnia. First episode of each month is always a topic about insomnia. And I really wanted to focus on sleep identity. When people say that they're a good sleeper or a bad sleeper, what does that mean? How are they making that determination? And how can you use that information to help yourself become a better sleeper and maybe tweak and redefine what you're using to make those determinations? If you want to get in touch with the show, you can find me on social media. My Twitter and Instagram is Dr. Chris Winter. You can also find me on TikTok if you want to look there. You're not going to find much, but you can look there. Our YouTube Sleep Unplugged page continues to grow in subscribers. So if that's how you're consuming this content, welcome. As I've stated in previous episodes, the catathrenia episode still continues to dominate on there. And I'm really happy about that, that individuals who have been patted on their head by their primary care doctor and said, listen, you know, sleep-related moaning is not a thing, don't worry about it, are finding some degree of information and justification, validation by that episode. It is a thing. It's real. I even do it myself sometimes. So if you're new to the show, welcome to the Sleep Unplugged podcast family. If you're a veteran, welcome back. It was a big episode last week. We did one on shift work. We've been wanting to do that for a while. Got a lot of great feedback from individuals in that space. And really happy that that content was sort of put out there. I'm going to spotlight very quickly a listener response that I received via Instagram that I'm very, very happy about. This is from Scott. Scott wrote, Chris, thanks so much for your podcast. I started listening about a month ago after searching high and low for sound advice for more than 20 years. Within a couple episodes, my approach and reaction to my sleep relaxed significantly. This won't come as a surprise to you, but it sure as hell has to me. I've been falling asleep faster initially, and when I wake up in the middle of the night and feeling rested in the morning much more consistently, I'm deeply grateful. Thank you. Well, thank you, Scott, for taking the time to write in. It really dovetails perfectly into the episode today, which is all about, are you a good sleeper? Are you a bad sleeper? And where you're getting that information and what you're doing with it. I think it's safe to say Scott felt like he was a bad sleeper for a long period of time. And with the podcast, some education, some reflection, it sort of started to change quickly for him. And we've talked about that in previous episodes, about how that transition from bad sleeper to good sleeper, when we're talking about insomnia, can happen quickly if the voice that you're hearing, the information you're receiving resonates. It can happen extremely quickly. And it's fun to hear from people like Scott when it does. And it's okay to hear from people when it doesn't too. So thank you very much, Scott. I'm really, really glad you're part of the Sleep Unplugged pod family. Real quickly before we get into the episode, our title, Are You a Good Sleeper or a Bad Sleeper? It Was My Attitude. It Was My Attitude is from the song Attitude by The Replacements. This was off their seventh and final Replacements album, All Shook Down. I think at that point, if you're familiar with The Replacements, one of my favorite bands, Paul Westerberg and the group were really fractured. They were falling apart. And a lot of what was on All Shook Down was intended to be sort of Paul's first solo project. And instead, I think his management said, hey, can you release one more Replacements song? And sort of like the Beatles' final album, it wasn't entirely a Replacements album. There was a lot of session players. I think they had like 10 different drummers or something like that on the album. And so even to this day, when you listen to the songs on the album, including Attitude, it's difficult to really know who's playing and if, you know, it was Replacements members or if it was session musicians, and makes me think about the album Don't Tell a Soul, which was their sixth album, the one prior to that, which I consider to be a masterpiece and still today one of my favorite albums. So there was something very sad, happy, hey, there's another album coming out in 1990 from the Replacements, but kind of sad that it really wasn't a true Replacements album. But Attitude's a great song, and Attitude has everything to do with sleep. So when we talk about sleep attitude or sleep identity, what are we referring to? And I write about this in my second book. I did a whole chapter about it in The Rested Child, which is really about when I talk to somebody about their sleep, or maybe about their child's sleep, and they say, well, you know, I'm going to bring you to see. I was just talking to a parent just a few days ago, and she said, you know, you'll have your appointment with my daughter. I wanted to talk to you about it. She's just a terrible sleeper. And it's always interesting to find out what follows that. And I think the way we construct sleep attitude is extremely important. The way we construct sleep identity is very important. And it starts from a very early age. What is it about that individual's sleep that's been going on for a long period of time constructs that view of yourself? So when I talk to a patient who says, I'm a good sleeper or I'm a bad sleeper, it's always interesting to know from what are you deriving that definition or that identity. And generally speaking, in my experience, it's usually coming from a few places. The first is, and we've talked about this before, how long it takes an individual to fall asleep. To me, I think that's king. So we throw everything out about our lives, our health, our ability to function during the day, and it all gets distilled down into one simple metric, which is, I've called before, speed to unconsciousness, STU, called STU, maybe. That's the acronym, STU. Speed to unconsciousness. It becomes the metric by which people define their sleep. Or their sleep identity. And we've said in the show, this doesn't really make a lot of sense any more than, you know, I'm trying to be a better eater. Oh, really? What are you doing? Are you going organic, trying to limit your meal size, trying to not eat past 9 o'clock at night? What are you doing to become a better eater? Oh, just mainly trying to eat much faster. I really want to make sure I'm trying to keep my meals down to, you know, 5 minutes or less. I'm not changing anything about what I eat. I'm just trying to eat it much faster. I don't think that we might view that with some skepticism, not only the reason why you're doing it, but the validity. How have you come to the conclusion that eating faster is making you a better eater? Where is that coming from? But perhaps if you grew up in a situation where that was encouraged, then maybe that's something that you would take into your adulthood. I don't know. But speed to unconsciousness becomes a big one. It fuels an industry, right? You know, it fuels the sleep aid, the hypnotic industry. There's a lot of news about melatonin this week, and the news was essentially, hey, listen, when it comes to taking melatonin, you have no idea what you're ingesting, if you're getting any melatonin at all, or three times the amount you thought you were getting. So that's big news. That kind of shook an industry. And before I forget, I do want to put out a correction from last week about shift work. I mentioned that there were three FDA approved drugs for shift work disorder. I did address this on my Twitter page. It's modafinil and armodafinil, the two FDA approved drugs for shift work. The drug Sunosi or Solriamfetol is not FDA approved, although it has been investigated. In fact, Chuck Seisler led an investigation that I posted on my Twitter page about it as a shift work drug. But as of today, no FDA approval for that. So just wanted to mention that very quickly. So speed to unconsciousness drives the reason why we're taking pills, and sort of plays into that belief about sleep identity. And I want to mention that Charles Morin, who we've mentioned before in terms of a very reputable insomnia researcher who's really a titan in the field, came up with a survey called the Dysfunctional Beliefs and Attitudes about Sleep Survey, the DBAS. And I think they're on version 16 right now. And there's different versions and truncated versions or whatnot. But what it really is, it's a series of statements that you can read out to an individual and sort of get a sense of where their beliefs fall, you know, the strongly disagree, strongly agree spectrum. And I'm going to read some out to you because we're going to highlight two surveys in this episode that I think are integral to how we think about our sleep identity. Are we a good sleeper or a bad sleeper? So this can be a very helpful tool to a cognitive behavioral specialist, a sleep specialist, an insomnia specialist, when you sit down with a patient to see where their head is at. And some of those questions are, I need 8 hours of sleep to feel refreshed and function well during the day. Strongly disagree zero, strongly agree 10. And maybe you play along as you listen to this. You know, if you listen to this show, you probably understand that 8 is in the middle of the bell curve distribution, but it's not what everybody needs for their sleep. And maybe you're somebody who understands, like we've talked about Jenny, trauma surgeon, that you can get less than 8 hours of sleep, function quite well during the day. Is it healthy for you? Maybe or maybe not, but you can do it. So where does that attitude fall? And for somebody who strongly agrees that they must get 8 hours of sleep every night to function at their best, well, that's certainly going to push people towards a medication or a sedative to create sleep quickly. When I don't get the proper amount of sleep on a given night, I need to catch up the next day by napping or sleeping longer. Once again, there is that thing. And we've talked about that before too, polyphasic sleeping, napping. Is it wrong to do that when something's kept you from getting the sleep you need? No. But if you're in bed and it took you a while to fall asleep, doesn't seem like you're really needing that sleep in that moment. You know, the necessity of sleeping for 2 hours the next day or napping for 2 hours to make up for that 2 hours, when you got 6 or 6.5 hours, you know, where do you fall in that spectrum? I think number three on this survey is a huge one. I'm concerned that chronic insomnia may have serious consequences to my physical health. And this is where we sort of get into the problem of confusing insomnia with sleep deprivation. I think there's a lot of people out there who would say, well, I definitely agree with this, because all I hear on the news is how sleep deprivation is a humongous negative when it comes to my physical health, mental health, everything about me. You said it, Chris, it's shift worker. On the last episode, you talked about shift work causing mental health problems, physical health problems, cognitive problems, cardiac problems. It's a carcinogen, Chris. So how could you argue that it's not? Well, the sentence is not saying sleep deprivation. It's talking about chronic insomnia. Let's remind ourselves what the definition of chronic insomnia is. We can go all the way back to the beginning of this podcast. It's not sleep deprivation. It's not inadequate sleep. It's an individual who's not sleeping as much as they think they need, and they're upset about it. That's our working definition of insomnia. I'm worried, number four, I'm worried I may lose control of my abilities to sleep. Isn't that an interesting one? That would be a very difficult situation for a sleep scientist to even find an example of. Hey, Chris, you know, let's do it. Why don't you do an episode about those patients that lost their ability to sleep? That's going to be a very short episode because it doesn't exist. So that's often getting at the core, right, of that second part of the insomnia definition. Not sleeping the way you want to. You're upset about it. Why are you upset? I think deep down, a lot of people are truly concerned that they're losing the ability to sleep, and will often tell you, well, here are the medications I take. And hey, before you even ask, I've tried to come off of the trazodone. I've tried to come off the melatonin gummy bears. I've tried to come off the Seroquel, and I can't sleep. We've tried to get our child off these medications. she can't sleep without them. Well, sure she can. She has. I was just on a podcast with two lovely women in Australia. And during the podcast, she said something like, I just need television in my bedroom at night to fall asleep because I can't fall asleep without it. And true to form, I said, well, sure you can. That's not a true statement. I've known you for 5 minutes. That's not true. So let's get into it. This would be kind of fun. More fun than the white noise, brown noise, green noise topic that you wanted to talk about. I like getting into it. So yeah, great green noise, white noise, brown noise, pink noise. That's all great. And we did an episode about it. It's fun. But what you said is really interesting. Oh, so you've got something like what? Like a gene or something in your eyeball that requires television light to fall asleep? Tell me about this. How did you come to believe this? Where did this attitude about television come from? And so you can look up this survey in order to function well the next day. I would be better off taking a sleeping pill rather than having a poor night's sleep. Charles Moore knew what he was doing when he came up with this survey. That is a fascinating statement, isn't it? That's an entire podcast episode. I believe I'm better off. We've talked about sleeping pills before in that episode. Why do people take sleeping pills? There is a belief. There is an attitude that, well, I'm a helicopter pilot. I am a neurosurgeon. I am a principal of a school. I'm a circuit court judge that sits on a bench right below the Supreme Court. So, Chris, I don't really want to take the sleeping pill, but I've got to be good at my job. I've got to function properly. And I'm going to be better off on the sleeping pill than without it, even though I wish I didn't have to take it, but I've got to function well. And we've talked about the complete lack of evidence that you're functioning with a sedative is better than without it. It's a very important statement, isn't it? I feel irritable, depressed, anxious on the day when I didn't sleep well the night before. Of course you did. Beliefs about sleep. I had a rough night last night. Oh, well, I've got a big day today. I'll be fine. Or I had a rough night last night. I might as well not even go into work because all is lost and it's going to be awful. And I'm already depressed and upset about the day because of what happened last night. Belief, attitude. It was my attitude, as Paul Westerberg said in the song. So I find these questions just absolutely fascinating in terms of what they're saying about the individual and what they're saying about the individual and how they feel about sleep. A couple more. When I sleep poorly on one night, I know it will disturb my sleep schedule for the whole week. And I think that's enormous for a lot of individuals in terms of when they're thinking about the nature of their sleep, they're drawing a consequence to that situation that has a lasting effect. And I've found that individuals, when they believe that there is a long-term problem associated with their sleep, that can be extremely damaging to the individual the next day. I can't ever predict whether I'll have a good or bad night of sleep. What do insomnia patients want more than anything in the world? They want control. They want to control the situation. Individuals who struggle with insomnia are quite capable individuals. They're the people you want leading, teaching, being in charge. They are detail-oriented. They've got things under control. They don't like things that are unpredictable. And to some extent, sleep is always going to be unpredictable, correct? So we're always going to have issues related to, I consider myself a pretty good sleeper. I have no idea what's coming tonight. All I can control is my attitude about it, which is bring it on. I don't really care. It doesn't really matter to me. And if tonight's bad, I'm sure tomorrow will be fine. That seems to be the pattern so far. So controlling that anxiety takes work for a lot of people. Function, the F word in any sleep clinic. Without adequate sleep, I can hardly function the next day. It reminds me of another replacement song, Can't Hardly Wait. can hardly function, right? Can hardly function the next day. Really? Have you ever seen somebody dysfunctional? Just truly dysfunctional. You know, I was talking to somebody recently about insomnia, and I asked them the question because they were talking in those kinds of terms. I'm very dysfunctional the next day. I said, what do you think would happen if I went to your office, which was a big office, gave everybody a piece of paper and said, I want you to write down the 10 most dysfunctional people in this office? I said, do you think you'd be on that top 10 list? And she, in a very honest moment, she said, no, I don't. In fact, I think I'd be on the list of the top 10 most functional people. Fantastic insight from this patient, that she's saying one thing, but actually believes something totally different. It becomes a routine, right? It becomes something that you just say that doesn't really have a lot of backing behind it. Or maybe she believes that, well, sure, I've been functional up until this point, but the next time my bad sleep happens, I will be dysfunctional. I have little ability to manage the negative consequences of disturbed sleep. I can't control what happens here with this. I think, again, we're kind of finding ourselves in that control paradigm. I want control. I want control of my sleep because I really want control of my performance, how people perceive me. I need that part of my life to be set up and situated so I can deal effectively with other things. I feel insomnia is ruining my ability to enjoy life. Medication is probably the only reliable solution to sleeplessness. I avoid or cancel obligations after a poor night's sleep. So I don't want to bang on the DBAS too much, but I do think these are important questions that when you go through cognitive behavioral therapy, and we talked about cognitive behavioral therapy in a previous episode, that was the, you know, this just in, this is the solution to sleep. That was episode 33, that these are the types of things that we work with patients to understand. So the patient says, look, I truly believe that medication is not what I need, but I do feel like I'm killing myself because of my insomnia. Then we kind of focus more on that versus, now, I don't know, I'm 60 years old. I've had insomnia all my life. I feel pretty healthy, but it's all because of medication. Like, you know, you sort of pick and choose the paths and things that you work on. And this is where sort of logical thinking can really help a patient with insomnia, because you start putting it all together, certain aspects of insomnia tend to make more sense than others. And what lends itself to having dysfunctional beliefs, what lends itself to for somebody who's actually a fairly decent sleeper to feel like they're a terrible or bad sleeper. We've talked about education to some extent, both on both ends of the spectrum, upbringing, the way you're raised. Psychiatric comorbidities are huge, and whether or not somebody comes to us having already been on medications, those are probably the top four things that, as you look at those variables, will predict how fast is this going to resolve itself. The patient who says, look, I've had insomnia for a long time, I've always avoided medications, is probably going to be a little bit easier to deal with than the person who's been on medications for sleep for a long period of time. You're having to tackle two things: the unwind the beliefs and attitudes you have about medication, while at the same time reevaluating, redefining, restructuring your beliefs about sleep. The other scale that I wanted to talk about, which we've mentioned from time to time, but never really gotten into fully, is the Epworth sleepiness scale. So as we think about what are you using to define what kind of sleeper you are, instead of the speed to unconsciousness, the stew, what about sleepiness? What about defining sleepiness? And we've talked a little bit about the differences between sleepiness and fatigue. I'm talking about drive to sleep. And the Epworth was created by Murray Johns back in the early 1990s as sort of a scale for measuring sleepiness. So we've talked about the dysfunctional beliefs and attitudes about sleep scale. Let's get a number value about how dysfunctional or functional your beliefs are. Well, we can do the same thing with sleepiness. And this is a much simpler scale. It's 8 questions. You can look it up. Again, Epworth, E-P-W-R-T-H. It's how likely are you to fall asleep in these situations? And first and foremost, it's do you, not could you. Chris, do you ever fall asleep recording your podcast? Listener, no, that has never happened. If the listener said, could you? Like if you stop talking right now and lay down and put your head down, do you think you could fall asleep? Maybe. Slight chance. So as you look at the Epworth, it's all about do you, not could you. And so there's 8 scenarios. How likely are you to fall asleep lying down to rest in the afternoon when circumstances allow you to? No chance? Slight chance? 50-50? Or definite? So going through it, how likely am I to fall asleep lying down to rest in the afternoon? I would say slight chance. So no chance is a 0, slight chance is a 1, 50-50 is a 2, definite is a 3. How likely are you to fall asleep talking to somebody? I would say that does not happen. Maybe back in my residency days, we were talking about shift work in last episode, that could have happened. It did happen, you know, falling asleep on the phone with people or at a dinner party when the conversation sort of steered to something kind of boring. Yeah, slight chance. How likely are you to fall asleep reading a book, magazine, or newspaper? I always add the qualification, not late at night, you know, during work hours. I would say 0. That doesn't really happen. How likely would it be for you to fall asleep watching a television show or movie? Again, during normal viewing hours up until 10, 11 o'clock at night, I would say slight chance. So far, I'm scoring a 2. What about sitting quietly in a public place, a lecture, a church service, a business meeting? I would say no. Again, there have been times in the past when I was in medical school, sure, that happened, but not really now. Sitting quietly after a big lunch. Again, I would say no. Passenger in a car for an hour without a break, I would say slight chance. And then driver of a car parked at the stoplight or stuck in traffic, I would say no chance. So that's the Epworth. I would score myself at this point in time as a 3. So when you look at the Epworth, what you're actually doing is trying to gauge somebody's sleepiness. We could come up with the winter hunger scale, which is 8 scenarios, which are food items you've been presented with. And you're telling me no chance, slight chance, 50-50, definite, you would eat them. Ear of corn, brownie, slice of pizza, cheeseburger. And if you're saying no chance, no chance, no chance, no chance, you're probably not hungry, or you really just don't like the foods that I've chosen for these 8 measures in my scale. If somebody was really hungry, had been, you know, deprived of food for a period of time, my guess is they're going to say, I'm definitely eating the ear of corn. I'm definitely eating the brownie. I'm definitely eating the piece of pizza, because they're going to take whatever they can get. They're driven to eat. So with the Epworth and the winter hunger scale, the higher your score, the more drive you have for either sleep in the case of the Epworth, or hunger in the case of the winter hunger scale, right? You could come up with a similar thirst scale. How likely would you be for you to drink a Fanta or drink a bottle of water or drink muddy water out of a puddle? You could put some pretty graphic things on there, you're right? And if somebody says definitely drinking the muddy water, then you can say, wow, this person from my scale, from this blunt little tool, is very thirsty. So when we think about our I sleep identity, and we think about insomnia identity, and we think about the confusion between insomnia and sleep deprivation, what you often find, by definition, the insomnia patient is not only struggling to fall asleep at night, but they are not good at napping. And when you ask them these questions, do you ever fall asleep talking to somebody? No. Gosh, no. Oh, I wish I could. Do you ever fall asleep in public places? No, that would never happen. Do you ever fall? So as you go through the Epworth with the insomnia patient, there's a lot of no's. There's a lot of incredulous, like, oh my gosh, I wish I could take a nap. I wish I could read a book to fall asleep. I'm lucky if I, you know, it's that kind of answer. Going to the shift worker, going to the narcolepsy patient, going to the sleep apnea patient, very different answers, right? Falling asleep immediately. Oh my gosh, I really don't drive much on long trips because I just fall asleep. I've really been struggling as a shift worker to stay awake on my drive home at the end of my shift. Like this is the kind, their drive is high. So when you do the shift work Epworth, you're scoring 20. Narcolepsy Epworth scores a 19. Sleep apnea Epworth scores a 14. Insomnia Epworth, 2, 0, 1, 4, very low. And I often find it interesting to pose the question to a patient, does it surprise you that you don't sleep or that you're struggling so much to fall asleep, yet really don't have any discernible evidence that your body wants it? Would it be surprising to you to realize after 7 days that you've just forgotten to eat and you're not at all hungry? I think that would surprise a lot of people. I think deep down, everybody believes, no. If I were to do that, there would be very strong reminders within me to get some food and eat it, get some water and drink it. Right. Because you have to have these things. So now we're back to question 4 of the DBAS. I'm worried that I may lose control over my ability to sleep. And not only that, but you're almost worried that you're losing control over your ability to sleep, but your body is not responding as it does when it's not getting something vital that it needs. It's beyond losing the ability to sleep. It's I'm losing the ability to sleep and not at all feeling sleepy because of it, right? And this really goes back to the earlier question. When I don't get the proper amount of sleep I need, I can't function. Well, sure you can, right? So is your belief that you're not getting any sleep or maybe 1 to 2 hours of sleep, but you're functioning so well that you're in the top 10 of people functioning in your office? So these are the types of things where you start plotting out, do you believe that a straight line, can go off in 2 different directions? It's like geometry and never run into each other. Okay, great, you do. So do you believe that 2 parallel lines in the same plane? So as you start kind of believing things and you start structuring things, you understand that, oh, well, actually, there's a reason why a tripod sits on the ground. 3 points can always be put into a plane. 4 points cannot. So the rules start to develop theorems and axioms, and you start having these little simple tools, and things start to conflict with each other. And that's how CBTI often happens with individuals with insomnia, that you start with fundamental atoms of belief. Do you believe X? Do you believe that a thirsty person will pretty much always want to seek water? Do you believe that sleep is essential to life? And as you start kind of answering these questions, certain things start to collide with one another. Well, you just said earlier you believe all humans to be X, but then you said that you were Y. So therefore, you're stating that you're not human. No, that's not what I'm saying. I'm definitely human. Okay. But earlier on, you said this. And that's what a lot of cognitive behavioral therapy is. It is bringing things back to fundamental definitions that anybody with some degree of rational thought would believe, and start reconstructing your beliefs about not only sleep in general, but your own sleep. It's a restructuring process. Are you a good sleeper? Are you a bad sleeper? I'm going to guess that most people out there who struggle with insomnia are much better sleepers than what they think they are. And as you start to explore these topics and get information, which can take the form of a sleep study, you can start to really peel back a lot of those beliefs and help people understand that their identities are, number one, maybe being formed by beliefs, opinions, and pieces of information that aren't entirely true. And that as we can reconstruct that identity, it can have a profound effect on your sleep. And it often doesn't take that much time. So I'm going to stop there. I really appreciate you listening. I think this is an important topic to think about. The homework that I would leave you with is, you're going to write down on a piece of paper, I'm a good sleeper or I'm a bad sleeper. And if you wrote down, I'm a bad sleeper, or if you wrote down, you're a good sleeper, what are the top five reasons that you're using to make that assumption? You know, we talked in the shift work episode last week. If the good sleeper, number one, is because I get in bed and fall asleep really, really fast, that might need to be reevaluated in sort of the opposite way. We have to watch out for that exceptional speed to unconsciousness. So check out the dysfunctional beliefs and attitude about sleep. Tally up your score. Send it to me. Let's see what we've got out there. You can also tally up your Epworth score. I'm a three today. What are you? And how do those two things jive in terms of your own identity as a good or bad sleeper? Follow me on Dr. Chris Winter Twitter, Dr. Chris Winter Instagram, Dr. Chris Winter TikTok. My books are The Sleep Solution, Why Your Sleep is Broken and How to Fix It. We really dive into it in that book, as well as The Rested Child, Why You're Tired, Wired, or Irritable Child May Have a Sleep Disorder and How to Help. Check out the YouTube Sleep Unplugged page. And until next week, sleep well.